morning.
Good morning.
How are you this morning? Is it still raining outside? No, huh? Okay, perhaps life, you agree with me that life is constantly a challenge to all of us, especially life in Singapore. We all want to live a life with the minimum amount of pain. And we want to have more joy and fun, isn't that true? Who want to have more pain in your life? Put up your hand now. I'm not one of those who put up my hand. But you see, we often hear people say, no pain, no gain. Do you agree? You ever heard of people say that the toughest the test, the greatest the success? Now you may have experienced great satisfaction of receiving a certificate. For example, for completing a marathon. I know beside me, we have a Deacon Rona have completed marathon. I'm sure that there are some of you who also completed marathon. The kind of satisfaction at the end of 42 km. Or maybe you have completed 180 km cycling trip. It's different here. No problem, right here. But for many of us, if we cycle 180 kilometers, you know, unlike Adrian and maybe Jose, it is a bit. Or maybe receive a certificate for passing your exam. Right, Joe? You know, it's interesting to get that day. Or maybe pass your driving test. You know, to pass driving test in Singapore is not so easy. You cannot go for a license. You have to make sure that you can qualify. Or maybe you graduate from a long and grueling course that you have taken. But as for me, the moment I received the tag, when I completed, the tag is put on my shoulder, completed the ranger course, it was the most, listen carefully, it was the most satisfying and the proudest moment in my whole army career. Because this course taught me the lesson that the deeper the humiliation, the greater the joy of victory will be. The deeper the humiliation, the greater the joy of victory. Because it is a course that is designed only for the regular soldier, the Tan Jia Man. It is a course to train leadership to the extreme. Rangers are trained to lead the others. It can be you're leading a whole formation. Rangers lead the way. Is always the motto. But all the ranger trainees are nobody. Listen, nobody. If you join the course, I was stripped of my rank as an officer, and I was called Ranger Lee, Ranger Lee. You know? Ranger Lee, come here, Ranger Lee, for that. And I must obey 100% without question. We were confined in camp 2 months, separated from loved ones and friends, and especially when you have your girlfriend. We were confined in the kind of a place that is not a place that for you to enjoy, not a holiday camp. Or holiday chalet, but every day the training lasts through the day and sometimes through the night. We were continually put under physical and also mental stress. Here is the picture you see on the screen. The gloomy faces of skinny ranger training. Now because we are in the midst of a prisoner of war exercise. We are ordered to be on our kneeling position, as you see, after an overnight interrogation and many hours in the dungeon. Some of you may have heard from my testimony. Now, this is just one of the many exercises we went through in the course. So I want to ask you this morning, what do you think? What do you think? Look at the ranger kneeling on the floor. What do you think is in our mind? Quit. Q-U-I-T. When you are in the course, you are sure to think of giving up. It is not working. Why am I here? Indeed, many quit the course in the process of the 2 months training. The course started with 58, listen carefully, started with 58 trainees, but only 13 made it to the end. Now, you can imagine how I felt when I finally received the ranger cap. In life, God gives to each of us different challenges in different stages of life. What is your challenge now? How are you taking it? Are you taking it willingly, patiently, as the will of God, as God has willed to you, so that you may experience the joy of victory at the end? Are you doing it now? Or are you struggling? That this morning, maybe in your heart, say, preacher, I'm going to give up. But if that is the case, I want you to hang on. I want to hang on and open your heart and mind. That the word of God this morning is going to deliver to you will change your mind. You must hang on, my dear brothers and sisters, no matter what you are facing now. Because at the end, if you trust God, if you have Jesus, you will experience sweet success. And you also be able to know that Christ has the power to see you through to eternity. You see, the Bible tells us that the Lord Jesus Christ, who went to the cross for us, as you have read this morning from John 19, verse 1 to 30, he showed us an excellent example of how a life is to be lived well. So this morning I'm going to focus on just the verse 30, when Jesus had said, had received the sour wine. He said, it is finished. You see, the route from verse 1 onward, the route Jesus took was to fulfill all prophecy of the scripture. That is, whatever God has planned for him to secure the final victory for sinners, Jesus was born to die for sinners. So the verse in John 19:30 is the sixth word Jesus spoke on the cross, telling us that he willingly tasted the sour wine because God the Father has included this portion in his mission on earth. Now, you may ask, why did Jesus do this? 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21 to 34 tells us that Jesus endures all sufferings on the cross until the end, and then he leaves us an example. Let me read to you. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, referring to the suffering of Christians, leaving you an example so that you might follow his footsteps. he committed no sin, neither was deceit found in his mouth. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly, referring to his Father. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, or on the cross, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. So when Jesus was nailed on the cross, bleeding, you have to imagine this morning. The blood of Jesus, of a sinless man, continued to flow and drip out of his body. But he fixed his eyes on the final goal. The final goal is the salvation of sinners. So he patiently endured, instead of complaining, according to Peter. He continued to trust the judgment of God as he faces injustice after injustice. And the Bible also tells us that Jesus became our source of strength, our source of blessing in his salvation work on the cross. And this is done through learning obedience through suffering. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 8 and 9, let me read to you. It says, although he was the son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. You see, it is through suffering on the cross, suffering for the gospel, suffering for the salvation of mankind, in the process that he learned obedience. And being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him. In other words, obeying God, listen carefully, obeying God in times of suffering, whatever that you are going through now, brothers and sisters, is the key to success and victory. When the sour wine is taken, the mission of salvation is accomplished. God is glorified. So, the implication here is this, that we are all called by Jesus to follow him, to follow his example of finishing well. Of finishing well in time of suffering. In the last days, before Jesus returned, before this world will just disappear and a new world will arrive, we will go through time of severe pain. So in spite of the unhelpful sour wine he has to take, Jesus was devoted to his mission. Jesus was loyal to God the Father with a deep love for the helpless sinners like you and I. So when the sour wine or vinegar is given to him, he took it in total, accepting. So let me ask you this morning, what sour wine are you tasting? What is discouraging you from being loyal to God and be faithful in your call? You may be suffering the pain of witnessing to non-Christian parents. You may be also finding difficulty in witnessing to non-Christian friends or colleagues. And when you are with them, you just feel that they are not the kind of a life that they should live. So you struggle in you. You may be facing opposition because of your faith in Jesus Christ, whether it's at home, in school, or in the office. But you must remember, my dear brothers and sisters, that all this suffering are necessary. All these are necessary for us to endure before the victory of salvation for these people can be achieved. So don't give up. Do not give up. They may be stubborn. They may be arrogant sometimes. They may be even rude to you. But this is the cross that we must bear. We are to continue in living an authentic Christian life. Do not choose the easy way out. Don't stop loving. Don't stop loving them. Don't stop witnessing for Christ because they need it. They need Him. If we continue to persist with willingness, with courage, then we will be like the victory that Jesus has secured for us. Very sweet. Very sweet. As we see here, when Jesus was on the cross, after tasted the sour wine, He says, verse 30b, it is finished. It is finished. Now, first of all, we need to be very clear about this. What does it mean? What is Jesus saying here? It was not an expression of satisfaction that His suffering has finally ended. A sigh of relief. Can't wait for the suffering to be over. Remember, Jesus willingly take the sour wine. That means He go for the full distance. He accept every suffering that God has intended for Him. Also, it is finished. It was not the despairing cry, a despairing cry of a helpless mother. You know, when you face death, you say, yeah, finished, gone. The life is gone. No, this is not. Jesus never said, finished, yeah. No, not swallowed by death. Jesus was born to die, you know, He knew it. This is where Jesus swallowed death. Instead of death, swallow Him. So this is a declaration. It is finished is the declaration of the Son of God, that all for which He came from heaven to earth to do was now done. This declaration has far-reaching implications that concern God, concern Satan, and sinners like us. First, God's anger against our sins has ceased. Stop. Heaven is open. It is now possible for sinners to be reconciled to Him because the punishment or the penalty of sin is fully paid by Jesus Christ. Therefore, as for Satan, his power is defeated, although it is not destroyed. We can see here in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14, I give it to you. Since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, He Himself, referring to Jesus Christ, likewise partook of the same thing, that through death, as a representative of sinners, through death He might destroy. The sense here is not completely eliminated, it is made ineffective. The one who has the power of death, that is the devil. In other words, there is still sin and death in this world. But Satan cannot accuse or threaten believers if the penalty of sin and death, because believer, that means sinners who believe, we have the power over death. Why? Because The curse of sins is removed. The curse of sins is totally removed. If that is the case, then death cannot touch the believers. The curse of sins is death. So John 11, 25-26 tells us, Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Resurrection and the life, referring to eternal life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. Listen carefully. Though he die, referring to the physical death, you will live continuously. And everyone who lives and believes in me, if you and I believe in him now, shall never die. That is what they mean. So therefore, if this is the case, then physical death becomes just simply a transition into a life that it is even glorious. You know this, D.L. Moody had this, this saying, or once he said this, someday you will read in the paper that D.L. Moody of East Northfield is dead. Don't you believe a word of it. At that moment, I shall be more alive than I am now. Isn't that wonderful for a Christian to have that kind of blessed thought? This morning I just received a fellow pastor's wife passed away peacefully in her sleep. She had been through a long battle with cancer. What I'm going to say is this, that if you look at D.L. Moody, he has experienced God, he has served God, he knows God. And he knows what it means, that at the end of our life, you are not going to lose anything. In fact, you are going to gain more. I will demonstrate this later on. So when sin cannot condemn us, and death cannot touch us, it also means that believer have power over the curse of the law, because Jesus Christ is the end of the law. How is it true? He lived a sinless life and he absorbed all the punishment the law demands for all our sins. You see, the law has two functions basically, right? The law is to punish or to protect. So since the punishment for sin is removed from us, what are we going to do with the law? What does it mean? It means that we, therefore now, as believers, can love the law fearlessly and can uphold the law wholeheartedly rather than breaking them. Isn't it wonderful? And not only that, we also have the power. We also have the power over the lust of the flesh. This is the internal, in our heart, internal self-centered craving, the lust of the flesh, craving that enslaves us all the time and lead us to death. But this is being crucified with Christ on the cross. Romans 6, verse 6 tells us, Paul says, we know that our old self was crucified with him, referring to Jesus Christ, in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing, so that we would no longer be enslaved to sin. This is basically talking about two masters. Who is the master in your life now? Basically, because of sin nature, our master, a very big one, is the lust of the flesh. But here, it is now possible, as we believe in Christ, we change the master. We become slave, we become servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. Why? He is the one who loved us and died for us, and to free us from the power of sins. You and I have the opportunity. You and I have the power. If we have Christ in our life, and not only that, the implication is that we believer have the power over the godless world. And now this is the hostility coming from outside, the external hostility, external opposition to our faith. Now this world offer us two things, or threaten us with two things: fear and faith. By injecting fear of death, and then inviting us to take refuge in temporal faith in the world. We see evil people everywhere opposing our faith through open ridicule and even open persecution. As you can see around the world, not so much in Singapore. Or subtle subversion, or even threaten to take our life. Christians are persecuted people in this godless world. But we all know that they cannot take our soul. They can kill our body, that they cannot kill our soul. Because we are secure. Promise of faith in superficial values of things in life. Putting many things to attract us to climb to the top and to receive many reward, that we will become nothing on the day of judgment. These are all empty and temporal. But the world will continue to offer in many ways, in many aspects of our life, everywhere that we go. We even find such value infiltrated into the church, the materialism, and then it caused the downfall. Money, power, and sex. So the scripture tells us in 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 to 17, John says, "Do not love the world." John is the one who always talks about love and how to love and what is God's love. John said, "Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him." Again, which one will you love? "For all that is in the world, the desire of the flesh and the desire of the eyes and the pride in possession is not from the Father, but is from the world. And the world is passing away along with its desire. But whoever does the will of God abides forever." Meaning, there's something that is so temporal, it may give you some sense of a short-term pleasure, enjoyment, but it will be over. But there's also another thing that will not pass away. It will abide forever. It will always be good to you. It will always protect you. It will always love you. And it will always do you good and not destroy you. Which will you choose? 1 John 5, verse 4 to 5. So John continued, "For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world." As I said just now, it is so powerful that the temptation is so great. You know, when you just join, I think before even you join the workforce in school, right, Joe? Everyone who took part in the O level or A level exam, you want to be top. Everyone who going to the workforce also want to occupy the highest position that he can offer. But sadly, I heard that there are people who occupy high position but not to work. They want the pay, but they are not willing to work. we need to overcome the world. John said that, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Our faith in Jesus Christ. Who is it that overcomes the world? Except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus is the one who died on the cross in our place to set us free. So therefore the implication here is that we are all called to live in the already and not yet. Live as victors, not losers. Live from a sure win position. I mean, we must live in a sure win position in spite of the sour wine we are tasting now. One day, if we endure, one day, the victory will be sweet. All this suffering is necessary for sinners. So therefore, what that is necessary for sinners is to rest now. Rest now on the faith. Rest now by the faith upon what Christ had done on the cross. So listen carefully. The moment we believe in Jesus, I hope all of us here in this room have done so one way or another. That moment we believe in Jesus, that moment every sin we have committed is blotted out and we stand accepted by God and have the power to live in this world which is still filled with sin and death. We will go through suffering like others, but we will arrive, listen carefully, we will go through suffering like other people, but we will arrive victoriously when death, the last enemy in our life, is destroyed. As in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 to 10 in our responsive reading, it tells us that Christ's suffering and Christ's death on the cross has resulted in the cessation of God's anger. And we become no more the children of wrath. Look at verse 6 and 7. This is what Paul said. It's very important for us to take note. Even now we are still struggling in this world. He said we are raised up with Him, with Jesus Christ, and seated us with Him, Jesus Christ, in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages He might show, there will be a great display, the immeasurable riches of His grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. There will be a great display on the day when this world, when this first old creations will be done away, we will see a brand new, eternal, new heaven and new earth. And we will be in it, we will be part of it. That is what Jesus went to the cross to secure for us. This victory of Jesus Christ secures us, listen carefully, second by second, minute by minute, for glorification. As we go through the sanctification process, the greater the suffering, the more mature will be our faith. So my dear brothers and sisters, if your faith is being challenged right now, Remember your high positions that is secure for you in heaven. So in conclusion, remember that He who declares it is finished is the very Son of God. Heavenly Father ever announced to the disciple, this is my beloved Son. Listen to Him. What He said is the guarantee in eternity. Do not take it lightly. So this message calls us to appropriate and to appreciate the victory Christ secured for us, for you and me. And then we do likewise for the sake of others. So the truth for life is that Christians are victors, not victims. Even in this cruel, unkind world, arrogant world, we are victor of the way. Christ then, in other words, Christ then redefined our identity. So you can have, all of us can have this new identity in Christ. And we seated with Christ right now in spiritual sense, in Christ in heaven. We are no more defined by job. We are no more defined by social status or your educational level or the house that you own or the car that you drive. Not what we have achieved, but what Jesus Christ has done for us. We hold on to what will last. Christ has become our all in all. So therefore, we must hold all else loosely, and ultimately, we fear nothing. Every conflict in this world, listen carefully, every conflict in this world, big or small, is resolvable in Jesus Christ. He has the power to resolve all our conflict, inside or outside. So live, we know that living in the already and not yet is difficult. That is why we must have the sure win mentality. Like the great apostle Paul who said in Philippians chapter 1 verse 21, he said, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." Or in the same breath, if we die today, if we die later, we have all, listen carefully, we have all that Christ gained for us on the cross that we're talking about this morning. That's what he means. Christians should live like a foreigner on earth, knowing that this earth is not our permanent place. So we must live with our head held high, held up, and our minds filled with the glory of Jesus Christ's victory on the cross, and then in anticipation of his return and final consummation. We can live and love freely, and after that transit into glory. Therefore, how long we live doesn't matter. Even if we have cancer, we will live with a more ready awareness that our life is a vapor. We could die, but it doesn't mean that we have to be cancer. We could die tomorrow in a car crash, or a freak accident, or a variety of other ways. We have no idea what God has in store for us. However, should God grant us longevity? Should God grant us a long life? We want to enjoy his victory every morning with his word, with his promise. And we want to enjoy the things that honor him. Using his victory to replace defeat in life. Using his joy to wipe away our tears and heartache. Because Jesus' victory on the cross is for us. He has become our peace. So live life in his peace until the end. This is the life from the cross. told you that the seven words, seven last word of Christ on the cross, that when I spent a month in LA, that the Lord has impressed upon me, this is a precious life. And today we have come to this conclusion. It is a victorious life. So, first thing, we have a life from the cross, a life of forgiveness. Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. We have a life of sure salvation. He said, today, to the thief who believe in him, you will be with me in my paradise. And we have a life of fellowship. Jesus said, behold your son, behold your mother. We have a life of great deliverance. Jesus said, my God, why have you forsaken me? He was forsaken by his Holy Father so that we may be accepted by him. And we have a life of suffering for God's purpose. And Jesus said, I curse. You receive not the fresh and cooling water, but the sour vinegar. Application. Two things. How does a life of victory look like? Two things, my dear brothers and sisters. Number one, resist evil. Number two, preach the gospel. Because we have been given the power of Jesus Christ to resist the devil. James chapter 4 verse 1 says, submit yourself therefore to God. You see, we are not willing to submit ourselves to God. That is why we are so powerless. We are so enslaved, we are still enslaved by the particular sins. Day after day, we keep going back to the same place, and then we keep regretting, we keep beating our head, beating our chest. But you see what is the secret here? James says, submit yourself therefore to God. You have such power that the devil will flee from you. Oh. The devil will run away from you. Chua-lua. Exercise the power of Christ. Say no. Say no to the particular sin that is still feeding you, maybe feeding your ego. Break free. Break free from that. Jesus give you the power and preach the gospel. Share this victory. Because this is a gift that's given to all of us who believe. Romans chapter 6 verse 23 says that the penalty for sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. So we are so privileged to receive this gift of salvation as we put our faith in Jesus Christ, say, no, I do not want to live my life in this way anymore. Lord Jesus, come into my life and take over. Take over the control. Take over everything and be the authority of everything in my life. And you know what? Your life will change. But I suspect our problem is that we are not healing. We still find that many attraction in the world. We do not want to lose out. You see, we do not want to be loser. We want to be loser. But the Bible clearly tells us, as what demonstrated on the cross by Jesus Christ, who came all the way, who died. All these things are history. You see, all the things that we achieve in this world, how many you have achieved already? I'm sure some of us have achieved quite a lot already, but I will tell you this, that when the day comes, the history on earth, who was the prime minister, who was the president, who received what golden globe or whatever it is immaterial. It will be made invalid. Like what Paul said, down. Cow down. Whatever down. It's useless rubbish. Of course, right now, you will see that there are many people who will be clamor over it, right? If you can get it, that will give you the satisfaction. But that is the promise. Listen carefully, that is the promise of the world, of an empty dream. Don't fall into the trap. Come to the Lord Jesus Christ today. Renew our time with Him. Renew our fellowship and our relationship with a God that who really loved us, who really would die for us, and who will definitely, eternally take care of us. Are we not worried about our future, our well-being? I was telling the EDC, I need to go for a full body examination. Because 5 years ago, before I entered this church, I said, to be fair, I think I better go for a full body medical examination. So therefore, the doctor can tell me that if there's something wrong with me, I will tell you honestly that I can serve, I cannot serve. Of course, the doctor treated me and gave me a very good report. So I told the EDC, you can. Okay, we sign on. But after 5 years, after the LA trip, I feel that there's a necessity for me to go for another checkup. As I said just now. You know how encouraging is this meditating on this sermon? Yeah, to me straight away. Pastor Vincent, if you go for the medical examination, the doctor say you have cancer, what will you do? That's why it's easy for me to preach a sermon for you guys to listen. But to apply it, I know. My heart go to your heart. It's not easy. But we need to believe in what the Word of God says. Every word, He will take care of us. He will take care of our future. We will not be a loser, but we will be a victor. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you. In spite of that struggle, the Lord, that we have to go through every day, at home, in the workplace, sometimes, Lord, we are quite anxious and worried about the future of ourselves, our family, our loved one, our work, our job, our education, our church, our ministry. Lord, how wonderful it is, that Lord, that we have heard from your word this morning. That it is finished. The power of sins and death defeated. Although it is still there. But Lord, we can live above all these things because we have Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord. In His name we pray.